Hello students, welcome back to this classroom, that is online classroom, which are run by the Department of Higher Education Haryana to provide you learning and education through its program of e-learning. And in this program, we are taking the classrooms to your homes. So in my previous lecture, I had covered the first part of the introduction to the novel and its forms. In this today's lecture, we will discuss about the various forms of the novel. And as you know, I am Vinita Gupta, Associate Professor of English, Government PG College, Sector 1, Panchkula. So in our previous lecture, we had discussed what does a novel mean, and let's have a quick recap of it, that novel is a literary form which is different, which is a little lengthier than novella and novelette, and the difference lies in its magnitude or the length. It is an extended work of fiction, we can say, and novel has certain major elements. Every novel should have a narrative or a story. The story should be systematically organized in the form of a plot, and every story should have characters or dramatis persona in it, who interact with each other, who perform certain actions, and these characters are, and the story is set in a setting, in a place, in a so which has a historical time and a locale and social circumstances, and every story is weaved around a central idea which is called theme. The writer chooses his own style or the choice of verse and sentences, and he should can have any tone in his writing. It may be serious, comic, satirical, romantic, fantastic, etc. And the story is presented through a point of view. It may be first person point of view, it may be third person point of view, and it may be the stream of consciousness of any character. So these are certain major elements of a novel. Now we will move to the second part of this thesis, that is the forms of the novel. Friends, you know that since its inception, novel has been written in various forms. Different writers have adopted different forms in the history of English literature. But many of these forms have become now outdated. They are no longer in use. But in some form or other, their elements are still to be seen in the current forms of writing. So let us have a look on what are these forms in which the novel was written since its beginning. So the first form which came to be evolved was the picaresque novel. As you see in the title, picaresque, the term is derived from the Spanish term picaro. Picaro used to mean a rogue or a knave or a carefree person who is also called a rascal because he has no morals and he is cynical, just like a highwayman who goes on roaming from one place to another. So journey is the main motive, travel is the main motive in the picaresque novel, because the picaro, the central character, he wanders from one place to another and he interacts with the people in different social milieus. And he has adventures there because he needs some means to survive and he cannot do any type of honorable work. Therefore, he survives through his own wits. And he is prone to cheating, stealing, lying, because I have told you earlier that he doesn't abide by the social codes and conventions. He has no morals and he doesn't pay attention to any of the social mores also. And ultimately, because of this illegal behavior, he is about to be punished everywhere, but he escapes barely the punishment for his unlawful activities. This picaro, till the end of the novel, doesn't show any sort of alteration in his character. Now, you be thinking over what was the aim behind writing such type of novels. So these novels were realistic in manner and they were written ironically to satirize the hypocrisies and corruptions of the society. For example, you might have heard the name of Swift's Gulliver's Travel. It is a scathing satire on the political parties, new scientific institutions, religious controversies during his time. If you have read Gulliver's Travel, which was written in 1726, you might have come to know that it is Gulliver who lands on an island and then he moves from one place to another. He lands on one island, then on another during his sea voyages, and he lands between Lilliputians and Brobdingnagians. So all this story is woven to satirize the hypocrisies of the society of the times. Moreover, picaresque novel present rich observations on people in the low walks of life. That is, the main characters presented in the novel and social milieu presented in the novel doesn't revolve around the courts and aristocratic people. Rather, the common man has become the hero of the novels, and these novels are episodic in character, episodic in their structure. Some more examples are Thomas Nash, The Unfortunate Traveler, which was written in 1594, and it may be called as the first English example of the picaresque novel, which was written in England. And in Spain, another novel was written by Cervantes, Don Quixote, in 1605. And this novel is a picaresque novel, and it is also called the most important progenitor of modern novel. But the picaresque novel, students, couldn't survive much, and it saw its decline in the mid-18th century because it was alleged that it didn't have good art history. The techniques used in it and the artistic tendencies shown in these novels was of inferior quality. But still, we see the signs of picaresque novel present in the novels of 18th and 19th century also, in the form of the use of satire, irony, detached survey of society, and mingling of the people from all walks of life, whether poor, rich, middle class people. The novel focuses on the people from all walks of society. And the language used in the picaresque novels is the realistic language and details. They can be found in the novels of 18th and 19th century, like the novels of Daniel Defoe, Robinson Crusoe, Moll Flanders, or Henry Fielding's novels, Joseph Andrews and Tom Jones, Dickens' novels, The Pickwick Papers, Mark Twain's The Adventures of Tom Sawyer and Huckleberry Finn. About Robinson Crusoe, you might have heard that he makes a kingdom of the island upon which he is shipwrecked. So these are certain examples of picaresque novel. Next form which evolved in the journey of novel is the epistolary novel. Epistolary, the word is taken from the word epistle. Epistle means letter. So these novels depend on letter. The story, development of the story depends on the letter writing. And the narrative or the story is conveyed by the exchange of letters between different characters presented in the novel. So through this technique, the writer provides multiplicity of points of view in his creation, and this creates the impression of diversity, which leads to consensus. And the most famous artist of epistolary novel was Samuel Richardson. He used this technique in his novels Pamela and Virtue Rewarded, or Virtue Rewarded, that is the novel Pamela, or other name was it Virtue Rewarded, and it was written in 1740. Samuel wrote one another novel that is called Clarissa, that was written between 1747 and 1748. But this novel also could not survive for long because the movement of the story of these novels was in reported form, and these novels, because they were written in the form of letters, they lacked dialogue and they lacked external action. So this could not become a dominant form of novel writing. However, in modern times, in our world, we can see a revival of this epistolary novel. For example, you can take the hilarious novel written by the American novelist Mark Harris, Wake Up Stupid. It was written in 1959. This novel is a story of a novelist who starts a campaign of letter writing, and this he does to escape his ironic situation in which he is landed, and of course he tries to escape his job. So this is all about the epistolary novel. Next form of novel which evolved during 18th and 19th century was called the novel of manners, or the social novels. As you might have guessed from the title itself, that it represents the mannerism, the way of behaving of the people, of the characters who make the society, who are the part of these novels. And these are social novels. It means that society must have been represented in its various aspects in these novels. So these novels are realistic in nature. They present customs, values of a highly developed society. The characters in these novels are judged by the set standards of society, and there are in this society there are certain standards which are fixed, and standards are for the behavior. And if the character are not up to the mark, they do not behave according to these standards, so the society ridicules them, they are rejected by the society. The scope of these novels may be particular, that is, the story may deal with the domestic affairs, presenting the different shapes of interpersonal relationship. For example, you can see the novels of Jane Austen. She was a great writer, and she presented microcosm of society in her novels like Sense and Sensibility, Emma, and or the society might be presented, these novels might present the provincial or public life. The novel of manners aims to understand rubrics of social life and intricacies of human relationships. Because these novels are social novels, it is so because of its typical social perspective. That is, these novels emphasize the influence of social and economic conditions of an era on characters and events. That is what the society was undergoing at that time, the economic, the political and cultural changes going on there, and what effect these conditions, these changes have on the lives of the characters. And because the characters are impacted by the social changes, the economic and political changes, so their behavior will certainly change, and this will change the events also, the action of the characters also. So that's why these novels are called the social novels. That's why these novels are the realistic novels, because they present the society as it was present there in the era in which the writer was writing. and indirectly these nervous, they recommend that some sort of social and political reform is required in the society. In this category, the novels which fall are Henry Fielding's Joseph Andrews, Tom Jones, and other novels. Jane Austen's novels are a very good example of the novel of manners, and her novels Pride and Prejudice, Sense and Sensibility, Emma, they focus on young heroines and they present a plot which involves the twist and turns of emotions in search for love, in search for marriage, happiness, and social status. And the novels of Jane Austen, she tries to create in every novel of her a fully realized and populated world, and her scope is strictly limited so that the readers who go through the novels of Jane Austen, they do not make any judgment on the characters, but their emotions of these characters, they can identify themselves with the emotions of these characters, because the faults of these characters seem to be very much human and their traits seem to be very much familiar to the readers. That's why these novels are called the realistic novels. Other novelists in this category are the 19th century novelists like Charles Dickens, George Eliot, William Thackeray, George Meredith, Thomas Hardy, and D.H. Lawrence. So here you can see Pride and Prejudice, different scenes from the novel which was written by Jane Austen. And in here you can see the caption within inverted commas, I quote, "It is a truth universally acknowledged that a single man in possession of a good fortune must be in want of a wife." So such type of themes ran through the novels of this age. Next important development in the history of novel is the Gothic novel. Gothic word has been derived from the word Goths. Goths was a Germanic tribe, and also this name Goths is given to the architecture of 18th century now, and this is called the Gothic architecture. You can see the picture here. This architecture was very specific kind, and it is characterized by these pointed arcs and flying buttresses often seen in English and French cathedrals. Gothic novel is also called Gothic romance because it focuses on the sufferings imposed on a heroine who is innocent and who is in distress also. Distress means pareshan heroines. The central character, the female character, leading lady of the novel, that is shown suffering at the hands of a villain or an evil character who is very cruel, crazy, and lustful. These stories are set in the medieval period. As you have seen here in this picture, the backgrounds, you can see that the atmosphere here, the settings will be the dark, gloomy castles. They might be having the things which create in the novel, in the readers or in the audience, horror and terror. And these castles can have dungeons, ghosts, subterranean passages, underground passages also, and sliding panels, thick forest, sensational happenings and supernatural happenings. Like sometimes there is wild storm raging and heavy rains falling, or howling of wild animals. You can hear the sighs all around, which create an atmosphere of horror in the readers. And crazy laughter is seen in these novels. And this laughter, the person who emanates this laughter is not to be seen. And the lights goes on and off automatically. Nobody is operating it. And there is mysterious disappearance. These are the certain factors which marked the Gothic novel. What was the principal aim behind writing these novels? It was about the sense of mystery, suspense, intense emotions also, the feeling of creepiness, anxiety, thrill, and horror, which was bone chilling. But this was not the main aim. These were not the only aim. There was certain other goal behind writing this novel. And these, the gothic novels, they explored the realm of irrational and perverse impulses of human beings. You see, whatever we are outside, whatever you see a person from outside, we are not the same. Because we have three levels of consciousness as installed by the psychologist, that is unconscious, subconscious, and conscious level. So you see a person from outside, it is our conscious level. We are behaving consciously. But there are certain aspects which are lying dormant inside us at our unconscious level. So these gothic novels, they explore that realm of human beings, where all type of perverse, irrational emotions are lying. So the main aim behind the presentation of such type of settings and scene was to expose the nightmarish terror that lie beneath the orderly surface of the civilized minds. This gothic novel form was started by Horace Walpole through his novel The Castle of Otranto, a gothic novel written in 1764. Other famous novelist was Anne Radcliffe. The Mysteries of Udolpho was a very famous novel, and Gregory Lewis, the monk, also wrote a gothic novel. You might have read the short novella, The Christmas Carol by Charles Dickens. There he uses some elements of the gothic novels. Next development of this gothic novel is the science fiction, and which is common terminology is called the sci-fi. Science fiction, science plus fiction, it is made of two terms. Science is factual, science is realistic, science is based on cause and effect theory, and fiction is imaginative. When we mix these two things, that is the facts taken from this physical world and imaginative use of these facts, the writer uses his imagination and creates a certain imaginative world, and with that science fiction develops. And this type of form developed in 20th century. So these novels, science fiction, foresees a future world. These writers, they try to imagine the future which will be full of advanced science and technology. That will be a world of robots, human clones, space explorations, time travel, parallel universes, extraterrestrial life, and what could be the potential results, consequences, and both ways, negative and positive results of such type of scientific development, and what could be the possibilities which can be utilized for the well-being of human beings. So all these things are to presented in the science novels. You might have seen the movie Star Wars. So this is a part of science fiction. And first science fiction was Mary Shelley's Frankenstein, which was written in 1818. You might have read Ramayana and Mahabharata in Indian epics, and you must have read the tales of Pushpak Vimana. You might have seen the both devils and gods, they were changing their shapes. Strange type of instruments, strange type of weapons were used by them. So all these elements presented in these epics, they might be called the beginning of the science fiction, because they were also the creation of the writers at that time. This novel may also be called the literature of ideas, because they inspire a sense of wonder in it. We can predict that new invention and progress will lead tend to improve life and society. So there is a sort of positivity in some science novels. For example, you can read the stories of Arthur C. Clarke, 2001, A Space Odyssey, a television series, you may see it, Star Trek, which started in 1966. It represented human curiosity to explore the unknown world and to find out the possibility of existence of new civilization. You must be reading the news that the scientists are trying to explore the possibility of human life on the planet Mars. And we are always talking about aliens. So these are the creations of science fiction. You must have seen the movie PK also. Other form of science fiction can move towards the negative effects of scientific development, and these novels present a pessimistic and depressive view of human society due to the scientific progress. These novels are called the novels of dystopia. And these novels were written as a social means of social protest against the totalitarian states. And they may also warn against the negative consequences of scientific development. And this dystopia is found in the novels of George Orwell, 1984, H.G. Wells' novel, The Time Machine, in which the human beings move into the future time. And they came across strange type of people and strange type of happenings. The Invisible Man also is a very interesting novel by H.G. Wells. Aldous Huxley's novel, Brave New World, which was written in 1932. Moreover, some modern, latest science fiction, they talk about the environmental issues also, and they raise their concerns about growing pollution, climate change, global warming, and total erosion of ecology due to overpopulation. For example, Whitley Strieber and James Kunetka's novel, Nature's End, which shows complete meltdown of world's ecosystems due to over-exploitation by the human beings. And these novels also reflect authors' concerns over the social and emotional scene in the modern society. Now we move to the next important development, that is the historical novel. These are realistic novels, make use of events and personages from historical past to add interest and picturesqueness to the narrative. And their content and settings, it is derived from the historical narrative, maybe directly or indirectly. Historical events are very crucial for the central characters and narrative of historical novels, and they use protagonists and actions to reveal the deep forces that impel the historical processes. See here the Indian writer Salman Rushdie. He has written the famous novel, Midnight's Children, which explored the history of India, 1947. It takes 1947 as the central point of starting of this story. Similarly, you may read Khushwant Singh's Train to Pakistan. In English literature, you can find the first historical novel was set in medieval England by Sir Walter Scott, Ivanhoe, in 1819. Dickens' novel, A Tale of Two Cities, which deals with French Revolution, Tolstoy's War and Peace, Margaret Mitchell's Gone with the Wind, and Indian novelist, I have told you, Salman Rushdie, Amitabh Ghosh, Rohinder Mistry, Pankaj Mishra. Another development in the 18th century was sentimental novel or the novel of sensibility. It developed as a reaction against the stoicism found in the 17th century. Here we see a shift from neoclassical ideas. And neoclassicism was an age in which order, reason, logic, unemotionality was given great importance. And these writers, the poets and dramatists of that age, they didn't give much importance to emotions and imagination. About emotional relationships, emphasis on sentimentality and sensibility, sympathy and benevolence, all these things are the key factors found in the sentimental novel. And in these novels, sometimes we can see intense emotional responsiveness towards beauty and sublimity. Because these novels arose as the reaction against the dry atmosphere created by the stress on reasoning and logic in the neoclassical age. In this novel, we can see the scenes of distress and tenderness, which were considered to be representing a personal gentility, his refinement, or we can say within inverted commas, their fine feelings. And these characteristics were related to the upper class people. These novels complemented social trends of the time towards humanism and the heightened value of human life. And also, a great development was they focused on the weaker sections of society also. And this gave rise to the movements, social movements for reforms, which centered for a demand around for the equality of human beings. Some examples are, you see, Richards and Pamela, Virtue Rewarded, we have already discussed these. Oliver Twist, Vicar of Wakefield, Lawrence Sterne's Tristram and Shandy, Henry McKenzie's The Man of Feeling. One important development in the history of novel is the psychological novel. Earlier, we have seen all the novels dealt with the physical action, action in the outer world. But slowly, as we move from mid-19th century towards 20th century, the writer focused on the reading of the psychological makeup of their character. So this narrative genre grew during the modern age in English literature, that was the period between two world wars. It focuses on the thought processes of human mind. It captures their inner reality, emotional, their spiritual, intellectual lives of the characters. And here the time sequencing is concurrent. It means that it captures simultaneously both external, or we call physical time, as well as the character's stream of consciousness or his thinking process. In that stream, our thoughts, you can see that there is no line drawn between the past, present and future. Sometimes our mind goes back into mind and we are thinking about our childhood, and suddenly we compare that to our present. We are imagining our future. At one single moment, we are traveling in all the three times. So there is no division of time in the psychological novels. And the greatest examples of these novels are Virginia Woolf's novel. One of them is Mrs. Dalloway, William Faulkner's novel, The Sound and Fury. These novels, they are concerned with the deep explorations and explanations of the mental state of characters' inner being, and they focus less on the external action. That's why they are called the novels of psychological realism also. So, the plot in these novels is subordinated to the delineation of characters. The major focus in these novels is on the exploration of the characters' minds. And other novelists in this genre are Henry James, Virginia Woolf, and James Joyce. Then we come to another important category of novel writing, that is the regional novel. These novels are set in a particular region, and this region itself becomes the participant in the story. For example, you might have heard the name of R.K. Narayan and the town he has created, Malgudi. The town grows in his novels. In all his novels, you can see from the first novel to the last novel, the town gets certain new things in it, and there is a certain growth in his novels, just like the human beings grow. So these novels give us insight into the geographical and cultural details of that space, that place, like the speech, the social structure, their customs of that particular imaginative place, so that this place becomes a vivid and living place in the minds of readers. And this also adds local color to the setting. In these novels, we can see the temperament of the characters and their ways of thinking, feeling and interacting is affected by this, the particular region, the geographical location. The region presented here is generally rural or provincial area. Besides R.K. Narayan, the Indian writer, in Thomas Hardy's novels, you can see the Wessex has a very important and living presence in all his novels. The novel prescribed in B.A. final syllabus, Kanthapura, is also a sort of regional novel because it deals with, the story is set in an imaginative small South Indian village. And Raja Rao himself has called this novel a Sthala Purana, that is the legendary history of a place. So this is all. These are the forms which are prescribed in your syllabus, and for the creation of this presentation, I have referred M.H. Abrams' Glossary of Literary Terms and also the book prescribed in your syllabus, the Kanthapura novel. And with that, we come to an end to today's lecture. Hope you have liked it. Thank you very much.